So we'll do our reading from this week's Rays of the One Light, which is a book Swami Kriyananda wrote based on parallel commentaries from the Gita and the Christian Bible. So he has 52 topics, one for each week, which he recommended people focus on. Okay. So this week's reading is Ego, Friend or Foe. So let's do the reading first and then I'll have a brief commentary on it. Truth is one and eternal. Realize oneness with it in your deathless self within. The following commentary is based on the teachings of Paramhansa Yogananda. Jesus Christ begins his beatitudes with the words, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." To be poor in spirit, Swamiji says, in such a way as to merit the kingdom of heaven, doesn't mean to be poor spirited. Rather, it means to see oneself as owning nothing, since all belongs to God, for all is a manifestation of His consciousness. Saint John of the Cross wrote, "If you would own everything, seek to own nothing." That which the ego relinquishes, offering it up to soul consciousness, is reclaimed forever in cosmic consciousness. Nothing is ever lost. Paramhansa Yogananda tells the story in Autobiography of a Yogi of the levitating saint Bhaduri Mahashaya. "Master," a disciple of this saint once said ardently, "Master, you are wonderful. You have renounced riches and comforts to seek God and teach us wisdom." It was well known that Bhaduri Mahashaya had forsaken great family wealth in his early childhood when single-heartedly he entered the yogic path. "You are reversing the case." The saint's face held mild rebuke. "I have left a few paltry rupees, a few petty pleasures for a cosmic empire of endless bliss. How then have I denied myself anything? I know the joy of sharing the treasure. Is that a sacrifice? The short-sighted worldly folk are verily the real renunciates. They relinquish an unparalleled divine possession for a poor handful of earthly toys." The Bhagavad Gita in the third chapter states, "All things are everywhere by nature wrought, in interaction of the qualities, the gunas. The fool, cheated by self, thinks, 'This I did and that I wrought.' But ah, thou strong-armed prince, a better lessoned mind, knowing the play of visible things within the world of sense and how the qualities must qualify, stands aloof even from his acts. Thus through Holy Scripture God has spoken to mankind." So I particularly like the topic ego, friend or foe, because Swamiji used to say it is both. Most of us who are on the spiritual path, especially in India, we are taught, we have to renounce the ego, we have to give up the ego and we have to expand. And before we go into that, Swamiji and even Master clarified quite well what ego means. And Master used to use an example that Ramakrishna gave. He said, what we call the mind in English actually has four aspects. Let's turn. Anyway, what we call mind in English has four aspects to its functioning: man, buddhi, ahamkar, chitta. And ahamkar, of course, is the ego, as we know. But Master explained that each of these four functions work in this way. He says, suppose you are seeing a horse. The mind is just a transmitting, it's the medium through which information gets transmitted from the senses, from the eyes to the brain. And so an image of the horse is transmitted to the brain, where the processing of that image has to take place. But the mind can't tell, is it looking at a horse or is it looking at an animal or a painting or whatever. But buddhi steps in, intelligence steps in, it compares with existing past experiences, past knowledge that's stored in the brain and says, this image represents a horse. So what we are looking at is a horse. And then ego steps in, ahamkar steps in and says, well, this is my horse, if it's my horse. And Swamiji said, well, as we are still fine, You know, we are still not caught in delusion, but then chitta feeling comes in and it says how happy I am that this is my horse, or how unhappy I am that this is not my horse, this is my neighbor's horse. My neighbor has a horse, why don't I have a horse? I want a horse. And so the whole story of creating more karma and more vrittis, which are whirlpools of desires, starts taking place. And so these four aspects, when they are unclarified, you see, they bind us in delusion. But the point that I'm trying to make here is ego is essential, because we have to know in this world what is ours and what is not. And the fun analogy I often use is, if I see in the mirror that I have not shaved, you know, how do I know that I should be taking my razor blade and shaving my chin and nobody else is going to do it for me? It's because of that element of ego. And if I see one day somebody in the class, let's say, has not shaved, what prevents me from taking a razor and starting shaving his chin without asking him? And that's the element of ego, which tells me, okay, this is the part that I am supposed to be responsible for. That part is not mine to be responsible for. And so it is an element that is very much essential. But the thing is, it sometimes traps us into thinking this is the reality. This body that we are in is our only reality, because the ego operates through the senses. It operates on the information that is received through our senses. So whatever is received there, that is what it believes. And so gradually we come to this hypnosis. Now Swamiji said that even the great masters who have achieved samadhi retain an ego. So Yogananda ji, in his poem Samadhi, which is there in the autobiography, he said, there is a line there which says, I the cosmic sea watch this little ego floating in me. And Swamiji said, you know, when they have to come into this manifestation, they take on the four elements, man, buddhi, ahamkar, chitta, because they have to function in this world, but they are not identified with those elements. So I, the cosmic sea, his consciousness is united to being this ocean of creation and beyond. But he knows that, but I am right now playing this part of moving this body. Swamiji used to say, when he walked with Yogananda ji in the last years of Yogananda's life, sometimes he would be in such exalted states of consciousness, it was very hard for Yogananda ji to walk, and Swamiji had to hold his hand, and master would cling to his hand and somehow stagger along, and he would say, in this state I am in so many bodies, it's hard to know which one I should keep moving, you know. And then he says, one day Swamiji was sitting with Yogananda ji and a few disciples, and Yogananda looked at a disciple and said, you have a sour taste in your mouth, don't you? And the disciple said, yes, how do you know? Because I am as much in you as I am in this body. And so these states do exist. The ego we obliterate also, for those of us who think, oh, is this true? Am I not the body? Yogananda ji said, analyze the state of sleep. And he would say that is the first step sometimes to really understanding spirituality. When we go to sleep every night, we forget so many things that we think are ours or our own. And he used to make this specific. He said there are these four states of consciousness. This is a bit scientific here, but bear with me. There are these four states of consciousness from where the body, the soul withdraws when it sleeps and when it dies. The first is property consciousness. When we fall asleep, does anybody remember which phone he owns? Or which car he owns, or how much money is there in his bank account? So property consciousness drops first as we fall asleep, the life force withdraws. Then body consciousness, when we are deep asleep, mosquitoes bite us and sometimes we don't wake up. The alarm rings and in deep sleep we don't hear it. But from there, muscle consciousness, somebody who's deep asleep, you'll see his arm is very hard to fold. Rigor mortis, partial rigor mortis sets in. You know, and we used to play this game as a child. I remember the YSS lessons has this technique to withdraw energy, you know, relax the body. And the suggestion is withdraw energy from one of your legs by visualizing it relaxing. And then try lifting, get somebody else to lift your relaxed leg, and then the leg that has not been relaxed, and the relaxed leg will appear heavy, and it does appear heavy. I have done this so many times with my mom. I remember that. And so the muscle consciousness. But from there into the spine, the spinal consciousness. We all have an astral body, we all have, even in our physical body, these knots, ganglia, that's what they are called. That's where the life force partially withdraws, and that's where it stops in sleep. And that's why it comes out again when somebody shakes you awake. But in death, Master said, from spinal consciousness, the life force withdraws to brain consciousness. It goes back up and from the brain into cosmic consciousness or to the astral body in general. And that is an irreversible process. And through technique of Kriya Yoga, this can be brought under our control gradually. We can learn how to get rid of possession consciousness, which is not that hard in deep meditation. If you enjoy your meditations, you will temporarily forget. Even in deep concentration, you know, if we are very focused on a task at hand, we forget which phone we own, which shirt we are wearing, what time it is. So these things can be done. But the full-fledged realization of this, the masters have, where Yogananda ji used to say, I have killed the ego. He says, I have killed Yogananda long ago. Nobody dwells in this temple but God. But the point to remember here is that ego is essential when we come back to this place to act our duties out. But one way to spiritualize it, and this is a suggestion I offer based on what Swamiji used to say. Swami Kriyananda, when he was in his 80s, in his last years, he said, Swami Kriyananda is just an event that I am responsible for. That this body, my actions, it's just an event that I'm responsible for. So coming back to our first analogy where that horse came into picture and the ego jumped in and said, this is my horse. Maybe we can instead say, this is the horse I'm responsible for. You know, so same, this car, instead of saying this is my car, this is the car that I am responsible for. These are my kids. These are the kids that I am stewarding, you know, I am responsible for. This is my body. So maybe this is the body that I am responsible for taking care of. So that brings the ego more and more into its right perspective. It tells us not necessarily what belongs to it, what does not belong to us, but what we are responsible for to act our roles out responsibly and what is not our headache. You know, somebody shouts at us, maybe it's not our headache to correct him. So as we detach from ego consciousness, even that comes in. You see, as long as we are so much in the ego, somebody shouts back at us, we shout back trying to correct him. But as we try figuring out, okay, what am I responsible for and what am I not? Then maybe sometimes we take a pause and realize, maybe I'm not responsible for correcting this fellow who's shouting at me. Maybe it's better I just walk away and not escalate whatever commotion is being caused. So there are these ways. Now coming back to the ego, I wanted to talk more about the ego as a friend, which is not really heard that much on the spiritual path. But Master explained the animals have a very low level of consciousness, awareness. And their ego also correspondingly, all these four aspects, man, buddhi, ahamkar, citta, are less developed. And that is why they don't, you know, anything that happens to them, just like us, they don't try to say, oh, this has happened to me. You know, I have seen many times a dog get hit by a car, it loses a leg. You know, it whimpers for like 10-20 minutes, but 1 hour later you come, maybe it's bleeding, but it still starts walking along on three legs. But us, if something happens, we take so much care, we are so much in pain, we need this, we need that. Sometimes a dog barks at another dog, you know, and by the next day it is forgotten and they are friends again. But somebody hurts us and we carry it for such a long time. Oh, that guy hurt me. And Master said, one reason we are not given to remember our past lives is because we generally remember the bad things. I have seen this to be true of myself, that if there is somebody who has done a lot of good for me, but one day he has not treated me right, you know, somehow that one memory is the one that I come back to. That time he didn't do this right. But even your parents, even your spouse, they do so much for you, they cook for you, they take care of you, but one day somehow they slip and unjustly shout at you and you hold it down as a memory forever. So Master used to say that's one reason that past lives are kept hidden, so that you can start anew in this life, start those friendships all over again. But coming back to the part I was talking about, unlike us, animals don't have that kind of ego, so they can't relate things to themselves like we do. You know, if there is pain, If there is hunger, they bark, the dog barks, the cat meows. We had cats and dogs at the ashram, and then it goes along its way, it gets food, it's happy, not happy. But we, because we have a strong ego, we say, oh, this happened to me, I am hungry, I am ill, I need to be taken care of, and this needs to be right for me, I need to do these things right. And so that magnifying power of ego increases our ability to enjoy, because that I is happy, more happier than an animal when something goes good, but it's also more sad when something goes wrong. And so Master used to say that is the main reason, you know, that the ego becomes a little bit of a foe, because we start asking the question eventually when we suffer, why me? You know, so many people, Yogananda used to say, complain about life. Why me? Why did this happen to me? Why did that happen to me? Why did this not happen right? And Yogananda ji said, well, there is a positive point there, because after asking this question in the wrong way for a certain amount of incarnations, we extract the right part of the question, why? Instead of saying, why me, we start thinking deeply, why? Why do these things happen in this world? Is there something deeper in this world to be learned? What is the nature of the true creation? Why am I here? Why have I been born? Why do I have to die? Why do I have to be hurt again and again, and sometimes have joy again and again? So that why, which was asked in the wrong way, as the beatings escalate, Master said, the beatings of life escalate, gradually the soul also reaches that level where it asks why in the right way. And that is why Master said ego is like the first guru. It is what pulls us to asking those deep questions of life. The animals, because they don't have that ego, they can't ask why me, but they can't also ask why in the right way. They have to come to the human stage of evolution where they can get this body and with that heightened ego understand, oh, this suffering is happening to me. Is there a way I can behave so this suffering mitigates? You know, so that is why the ego also becomes a friend. But we want to make it a bigger and bigger friend by keeping it with us in the right way. And Swamiji in his writings, Yogananda ji in his writings, lists two or three ways, very nice ways in which we can do this. One, of course, which I suggested was, instead of thinking of something belonging to us, we can always think, I am stewarding this, I am responsible to this for now, but I don't want to think of this as belonging to me. And Master used to say, all those desires, all those attachments, they will otherwise keep bringing us back. My personal joke on that is, an international airplane has 30 kilos of luggage, that's allowed, belongings, and domestic airplane has 15 kg, but the astral airplane has 0 kg, you know, all the luggage that we have to leave here, but the attachment might remain and we might have to come back to try and reclaim. We cannot reclaim it. Though, as Swamiji puts it here, in Samadhi, we do reclaim everything. Yogananda ji once told a disciple, don't think you are losing something by going for spirituality. Nothing is lost in God. Nothing is too lofty in God. All your desires, all your fulfillments, all the things you wanted, find God first, and then in that consciousness you will see they are all yours. So, apart from this, a couple other things I want to point out. One is Karma Yoga, which the Gita talks about so much. Blessed are the poor in spirit. That's what Christ is also saying here. Helping others, Master said, it makes us forget this little self and focuses us more on the bigger reality. Feeling everybody is a part of that same reality. And so that is very important, relinquishing the fruits of our actions. And the Gita statement there is pretty high. It says those actions are not our actions anyway. Those three gunas propel us to actions. And we think we are the ones acting. And so we think Karma Yoga is relinquishing the fruits of action. But here the last line of Gita says, a better lessened mind stands aloof even from his acts. You know, even the part of acting, he stands aloof from thinking this is my action, because whatever is my, the rewards of that action have to come back. Good karma has to come back to us, bad karma has to come back to us, and there is no fine line. There is no such thing, Yogananda used to say, as good karma and bad karma as we understand it, because that which we think good still binds. I mean, if I have the good karma to be a millionaire in my next life, I have to be born, you know. And is that good karma for me? I don't know. And Yogananda ji used to say, chains though made of gold still bind, you know. So bad karma is the chain of iron, but even if it's made of gold, it's still going to bind us. And so we want to become more and more free by living in this world according to these principles. I have here a third principle that I wrote down, meditation. So karma yoga goes hand in hand with meditation. And Swamiji used to say one of the best ways to break the identity that we are this body is to know that we are something more. So through deep meditation, and the technique of Kriya Yoga was brought for that, you can perceive, you know, you can perceive God in one of those aspects that we talk about, especially as inner light that comes at the point between the eyebrows, or as the inner sound of Om. And when you see that light, when you hear the Om sound, Yogananda ji said, gradually your consciousness starts merging in that so deeply that you see this light has created this body, and it has created this whole universe. And in that state, there is nothing left to believe or disbelieve, because you know. And Swamiji used to say, one deep experience of God will free you of more karma and more ego than thousands of kriyas or thousands of hours of meditation. But those meditation efforts are necessary to gain that experience of God. And when that happens, we automatically know. That's why Yogananda ji said, practice meditation, but sometimes if we only meditate, in the ego, instead of subsiding, starts escalating, because we start thinking, oh, I see this light, I go in the inner silence, I feel great joy. These other guys, you know, what are they doing? They are just existing regular lives. And there, what are we doing? So, Swami Sri Yukteswar ji used to tell Yogananda, remember, some people forsake ego on the physical world only to reclaim it in the astral plane, in astral miracles. And that ego is even harder to take away, because that is substantial. The capability to see the inner light is more substantial than the, you know, ego of having a lot of money, because that money sometimes just drops to zero, stock market crash or something. So physical ego is very easy to be shattered. Or a millionaire, you know, Sharad Pawar, we saw, great CM, ex-CM, great minister, somebody came and just slapped him. You know, and there all the ego just goes away, that he can be slapped, you know. But the spiritual ego is harder to be taken care of. And so we want to be very careful that on the path of Dhyana Yoga, we are making sure our meditative efforts are reducing our ego. And that's why Yogananda ji tied Dhyana Yoga with Karma Yoga. He said, you have to also be serving and serviceful. Each activity, make it as if you are doing for God. And I had a clip I wanted to play, but I can't find that clip. There is another clip which will serve the purpose. And this is one where Yogananda ji talks about a story of Vyasa, how Vyasa used to always act with the consciousness of acting for Krishna. So in a bit we will hear to this also. One other way that we can take care, Swamiji has an article, how to be a ego detective. So anyway, one way we can take care of trying to ensure that we are not increasing our ego is one of the Yama's Niyamas of Patanjali's Swadhyaya, self-study. And Swamiji said, well, it actually means two things. Study of the little self, which is our personality, and also study of the cosmic self. But here I want to recommend the first part, study of the little self. And Swamiji said, observe yourself. How do you talk? Observe the tone of your voice, you know. How do you walk? How do you sit? How do you behave with your colleagues, with your family members, those you love most, those you hate most? So study of the little self. And the more we do that, we can start finding out gradually, this can be changed, that can be changed, this is how I can improve. So that also is a very good aid to helping us diminish our ego. But the icing on the cake, Yogananda used to tell this story, because we have talked about all the ways we can diminish our ego. Yogananda used to say, once he told a disciple that it's only the hypnosis of Maya where we feel we are this body, we are not free, that holds us down to this plane. You know, if in samadhi you just say I am free, you can be freed of all past karma also. And another disciple was hearing this, he said, but wait a minute, sir, if I just said now I am free, I wouldn't be free, right? How can I that work? And Yogananda ji said, you would be, but you have answered your question. You have said I wouldn't. See, your affirmation does not lack the strong force it needs to say 100% I am free. And he said that is the reason you need the help of a guru. There is a story in the Indian scriptures where a person was being troubled by a demon, and he read in the scriptures, take a particular powder, chant a particular mantra on it and throw it on the demon, and the demon will cease to trouble you. So he took the powder, he chanted the mantra, and when the demon came, he threw it on him. And the demon only laughed. He said, well, before you could chant your mantras, I got into the powder. Now how can it hurt me? You know? And Master said, that is what is true with all spiritual aspirants. The mind with which they are trying to get rid of Maya is already infected with Maya. So it lacks the 100% force. And that's why attunement with the Guru, somebody who has himself come out of delusion, is essential. By attuning to that consciousness more and more, and a part of that attunement is deep meditation that he has suggested, is serving others, but more and more by that attunement, gradually we start taking his level of consciousness, it descends. Some of Yogananda's disciples, and this is true of many other masters when we read the stories, those who are highly in tune, they could just transmit. Shakti path, they call it, or whatever, they could just transmit a higher state of consciousness. And those of us who are not at that state yet, we have been given Kriya Yoga and we have been given the path of service. So I also wanted to talk before we played this clip about what are the signs of ego consciousness, and this is more for fun. You know, how do we know we are in ego consciousness? And I'm putting this out for fun. If we think things over rationally, we are in ego consciousness. And here's the example I will give. One day Swami Vivekananda, he was in England, he was walking with a female disciple, English disciple, and a male English disciple through the fields, when suddenly they saw a mad bull running towards them. And of course the guy, the English guy, he forgot everything else and started running, and you know, jumped the fence, got to the other side. The English lady also started running, but she had lesser stamina, so she had to stop in between, and she just collapsed there. And Swami Vivekananda, you know, mentally he said, well, I can't leave this English disciple, lady disciple, so he just went in front of her and, you know, stood up right there like that in front of the bull. And at the last moment the bull just stopped and ran another direction. And the guy was watching from the other side of the fence. Once things were very safe, he came back and he was very, very embarrassed that he left these other two guys, including his guru, to be thrown away by the bull, and ran on the other side. And he asked Swami Vivekananda, you know, how did you manage to stand calm when that bull was charging you? And Swami Vivekananda said, well, I was calculating how many meters I would be flung when it hit me, when the bull hit me. You know, if somebody knows projectile motion, there are maybe all those formulas, he was using one of them. But then he said, I have touched the feet of Shiva, how can these little things scare me? You know? And in one of his letters to somebody who had sent him to the Parliament of Religions, 1893 or 1896, whenever it was, he said, you gave me $180. Well, I have been here 2 days and like $30 are already gone. I just don't know how this will work, how I will stay here, how everything will work out, and I have a good mind to come back to India. But I have received a call from above and I know it will work and I must stay. And this is a true thread of all masters, that they don't calculate the math out, saying, oh, I need this much money, I need these many letters of introduction. See the way Yogananda ji went to America. He saw this vision in Ranchi that God is calling him to America. Same day he gave up his duties as a headmaster, and in the afternoon train he was already traveling to Calcutta. He didn't know how he would get a passport, where the money for travel would come from, who would take care of him. And everybody was making fun, how are you going to go to America, you know? And he said, I don't know, Divine Mother says so, it will be so. And he went to the railway office, they told him, no, the shipping office, they told him, well, World War I is on, It's just going to end in a few weeks. 1920s when Yogananda went to America, there is no possibility. All transport has been stopped. There is no ship that will take you from here to America. And he said, no, I am going. You book my berth. If there is any berth that is free, you book it. And he says, well, you don't even have a passport. The British guys will take years to give you a passport. Everybody is under suspicion, this, that. So it doesn't matter. I am going. So this guy was very mad and he just refused to talk to Yogananda. But then Yogananda ji goes back home and somebody tells him, his dad tells him, go find this, give this and this to your uncle. There is some package to give. So Yogananda ji goes, gives it to the uncle and tells him, I am planning to go to America. And uncle says, he was advocate. Oh, you will get a passport here. Let me introduce to the judge. You know, on his recommendation, you will get the passport. And the passport came right away. World War I stopped at that moment. And so Yogananda ji, takes the passport and tells a friend, let's go visit the shipping office. There he goes to the shipping office and says, he plays a game with this guy. He just cuffs and that guy refuses to look at him. And Yogananda says, no, come here. And he says, where is my berth? B-E-R-T-H. And the guy says, where is your passport? Where is my berth? Where is your passport? And once this goes on for a few times, the guy says, well, it is true. One berth has been vacated. It's first class. You wouldn't be able to afford it. And Yogananda ji said, no, block that berth. I am going in that berth. Mind you, I have no single paisa with me, but I am going. Here's my passport. And that guy was flabbergasted and he said, well, I'll block it. You need to give the down payment. Now, this is very interesting because Yogananda ji doesn't put a lot of emphasis on his own greatness. But think about it. The first liner, City of Sparta, to go after 4 years from Kolkata to America. How hard would it be to find a berth on that? First liner in 4 years, but he got it. He got it first class. Divine Mother wanted to take him first class. And so he was home and his dad got this news and says, oh, I heard you are going to America. You know, his father had attraction for his son and he didn't want him to leave and go far away. And he says, but who's going to finance you? And Yogananda, he said, God. And father said, don't come to me. His father was wealthy. He was a very senior officer in the railways, Bengal Nagpur Railways. I am not going to finance you. And Yogananda said, but I never asked. It's all right. But Divine Mother might put it in your mind to finance me. And he says, never. And next day when Yogananda ji came to the dining table or wherever, there was this huge check his father had written to him. Signed and said, Yogananda ji went to his father, said, sir, father, I want to return this check because you might have been pressured to give this. He said, no, I was very adamant. I'm not going to allow my eldest son to go to America. But God did not let him sleep. His father was also highly advanced Kriya Yogi. Until I signed this check, God did not let him sleep. And I am giving this to you not as your father, but as a brother disciple of Lahiri Mahashaya. Take these teachings of Lahiri Mahashaya to the West. And so one by one, Yogananda ji did not know how to speak English. And there is that state encounter, he talks on that ocean liner, somebody found out he was the Indian delegate to this huge parliament, says, sir, why don't you give a talk in English on the battle of life and how to fight it? And Yogananda ji tried his best, jotted down a few points, but he had never lectured in English before, and he stood before that salon, no words would come out, 3 minutes, 4 minutes, and then he remembered his guru had told him, English or no English, your words on yoga will be heard in the East. Now the guru, being God realized, also never thought logically. See, English or no English, your words on yoga will be heard in the West. From that level of consciousness, you don't work with logic. And here Yogananda ji remembers that and prays to his guru, and suddenly he delivers this lecture in perfect English. So the point I am trying to make here is not that we should be irresponsible and try to think everything out by intuition. But we think, being born in this age of science, that logic is the most refined of our human faculties. And the great masters say, no, it is more refined in some ways, yes, but there is the faculty of intuition which comes when you break this bond of ego. The great masters, they just act and they know this is how things will work out from the inside out. They don't have to do the math. Masters sometimes joke, God does not come to understanding by the dialectics of reason. You know, and he used to say, 1 crore are black, 2 crore is black, 3 crores are black, and so all crores are black. You know, this inductive reasoning is false. 1 million crores have been found to be black, so all crores are black. This inductive reasoning is false because they found white crows in Australia. And he says, so it is. People think one man is mortal, another man is mortal, 6 billion men think they are mortals and physical bodies, so all men are mortal. And that is not true. As we practice these teachings gradually, this is the promise Yogananda ji gave. He who does not believe in the divinity of his own self, if he practices these teachings, especially Kriya Yoga, he will be forced to see the divinity of his own self. You know, it will manifest gradually. So while we are on that, I want to also play this little clip of Swami Paramhansa Yogananda talking about how to stay, how to live in a way that we don't increase our ego consciousness.
There was a great saint, his name was Vyasa, he was the writer of the Bhagavad Gita, the Hindu Bible. And he was sitting by the river Jamuna, and the disciples of Krishna, the greatest prophet of India, they were carrying some cheese. Krishna loved cottage cheese, but he lived on the other side of the river Jamuna. And Jamuna was in flood, and all the boats were sunk. So they very much felt for their master, and they saw Vyasa was in samadhi, he was in ecstasy with God. And they sat around Vyasa, and Vyasa woke up and said, what can I do for you? They said, Krishna is on the other side, and we want to get this cheese to him. The master has not eaten, and the Jamuna is flooded, and we have no boats. Could you tell some way how you can get there? He said, well, you think of Krishna, what about me? I have to eat something. Vyasa was also a great student of Krishna. They couldn't understand how he dared to eat before the master. He says, yes, without myself eating something, I can't do anything. So he ate all the cheese that he could. Then he stands by the river and says, O river Jamuna, if I have not eaten anything, divide up and part. Jamuna parted. Then the students of Krishna said, he ate the cheese in front of us and says, Jamuna, if I didn't eat anything, divide up and part. And the Jamuna, wait. They couldn't understand. They hurriedly passed through. And when they went on the other side and near the camp of Krishna, Krishna used to always in greatest joy meet them. He was sound asleep and his little tummy seemed to be filled. So they woke him up and said, Master, your cheese is here. Oh, Lord, absolutely. The master, aren't you interested in cheese today? Oh no, he says. The other fellow sitting on the other side of the river fed me too much. We didn't know when he was eating, he was only giving it to Krishna. So you had given us this joy. Think of him. Whatever you do, give it to him. Do that. And you will find him all the time with you. Yomam pasyati sarvatro sarvancho mui pasyate. Aham tang na punashyami, sachame na punashyati. He who watcheth me always, I will watch him always. To the flowers and the stars and human beings, he never loses sight of me, nor I lose sight of him.
So did people get that story? More or less? Did you? Well, just to summarize in a minute, the river Jamuna was in flood and these gopis wanted to take cheese to Krishna, but they couldn't go because there were no boats, and Vyasa was sitting on the right side of the river. So they went to Vyasa and said, help us go to the other side. And Vyasa said, well, you always think of giving him cheese, but I want some cheese also. Without me getting cheese, I can't help. And so he ate a lot of cheese, and the disciples gopis were mad at him, but they couldn't do anything. And so after eating, he goes to Jamuna and says, oh river, if I have not eaten anything, divide up and part. And the river just parted, and the gopis were so surprised. He ate 3/4 of the cheese in front of us, and he tells this river, if I have not eaten anything, part, and it parted. But they didn't wait to figure it out. They just went to Krishna, who was sound asleep, instead of eagerly waiting for them. And when they tried to give him cheese, he said, oh, I am so full. Who gave you cheese? And he says, that guy on the other side, he's fed me too much. And Master said he was only thinking of Krishna when he was eating the cheese. And it was a lesson to the gopis that whatever we are doing, we have to offer that action to him. So let us close this section with our usual healing prayers. Let's sit still for a minute. And if there is somebody you want to pray for, bring him to your mind's eye. Some situation that you want guidance on, bring him to the mind's eye. Bring that situation to the mind's eye. Surround that person or situation with light. Asking our Mother Divine to do as she sees fit, offering that person, that situation to it. Let's add our blessings, our prayers to this visualization. Let's all pray together. Divine Mother, Thou art omnipresent. Thou art in these Thy children. Manifest Thy healing presence in their bodies, in their minds, and in their souls. Let's rub our palms together. Let's send these blessings out as waves of foam. Oh.